Tony Trench sadly wanted to be liked, and this is a luxury that headmasters can't afford. At Bradfield also, he was it was a smaller school, and he was able to do everything on a personal basis, and there I believe he was a great success. At Eton, having to run through committees of people who themselves had quite a high opinion of themselves, I think he found rather trying. And there was one slight problem, which was that the provost, who is the chairman of the governors, lives on the premises. And the provost at that time was a man called Catcher, Harold Catcher, who'd been something very grand in the Foreign Office. And as well as being provost of Eton, he was also chairman of the Midland Bank. And he used to spend the weekends at Eton, and he was in London during the week doing the Midland Bank. And as I understand it, poor Tony was told to sort of trot along. Tony was a little man, so phrases like trot along rise to mind, to the provost's study to receive his orders for the week. That is anyway, is what we heard. And Catcher wanted to make his mark, presumably as a modernizer. And one of the sort of things that the modernizers have always focused on was the Eton uniform. Nowadays, the uniform survives, but they don't have to wear it all the time. Down the years, they've worn it rather less. And for instance, there was a time, I can't remember if it had stopped by the time I got there, when they had to wear it in Windsor, so that they were very conspicuous in Windsor. There may well have been reasons for that. But anyway, the uniform is what we call the penguin suit, the handsome long black tailcoat and trousers, and a white shirt. And the younger boys, if you're not a very, very grand person, you have a simple collar with a little white tie, which is not like a bow tie, it's slightly different. And this is held to be, it's a very public symbol of sort of being very out of date. It's essentially 19th century hunting costume. And the modernizers, so far as the school's image is concerned, were anxious to get rid of it. I was glad to say, the other day I was in Harrow, and I was glad to say they've still got their straw hats there, even now in 2010. And the tale we had was simply that Catcher had decided that we must make the gesture and gave Trench's orders that the school uniform must be modernised. Well, the problem about any modernisation or any programme of change is you've got to get some sort of agreement what you're going to change to. And when Trench felt himself more or less forced to have a meeting, a master's meeting, to discuss the question of whether the school uniform would be changed, and poor man, he obviously knew that this was a contentious issue. In fact, if only, I'm not sure at that point, the survey had been done, because the school newspaper at this period certainly did a survey of the boys and found the majority of the boys were in favour of retaining the school uniform. You'd have thought that ought to settle the matter. But the modernisers, of course, wouldn't take no for an answer. And so a meeting was called, and it took place in the theatre, which is a convenient and comfortable meeting place. And Tony was terribly late. 20 minutes or something like that. And when he appeared, it was perfectly clear that, knowing that this was going to be a contentious meeting, he had fortified himself against the unpleasantnesses to come. His tale was that he'd been sitting in his garage and couldn't somehow get the car into reverse gear. Well, it only takes 5 minutes to walk from the headmaster's house to the theatre where the meeting was taking place. And I felt sorry for him, because, first of all, person after person got up and said they didn't, that the uniform was perfectly satisfactory. The scientists said that it was rather like a modern motor car, because it was modular. In a modern motor car, if you damage one bit, you can slot a replacement in just to that section. And apparently, the Eton tailors are so have got it down to a fine art that they can replace a portion of a tailcoat and get it ready for another 5 years' use and all the rest of it. I was, in a way, well, what could they do having to replace it? Well, one of the ideas was a suit. And it was said, well, that would be very practical for our poor, hard-up parents, because the boys can wear the suit in the holidays. And somebody pointed out, I think probably correctly, that no boy is going to wear his school uniform suit in the holidays. You know, that they will not just not wear it. So that kiboshed that element. And poor Tony was had been told off, as we believed, by the promise to get us to agree to a change in the uniform. I had a scheme which I did not put forward, which is I thought if you want to modernise it, let's take the essence of the present one and transform it. So I wanted them to wear black jeans and a black denim jacket and a white polo necked pullover, which I'd thought would make a very handsome uniform. But I was smartly told by those that know about these things that, you know, jeans are and jeans jackets are made of in pretty crummy material and all the rest of it, and that whereas the Eton uniform lasts forever, we were told. At the climax of it all, the poor man, there was an American master called Dr. Clark, who was doing a year's exchange in the school, and he was so besotted with the senior boys that he actually wore school uniform himself. Tony hadn't quite worked out that it was school uniform he was wearing, and just said, oh, you always wear a tail coat. Dr. Clark, you come from America. Modernity. You know, what do you think about this? And then, of course, Dr. Clark said, oh, I think the uniform's wonderful. Which he was wearing it. So that ground to a halt. And I, with my compassion, like I may call it, knew it was getting, because I did have a notion, because you see, at Eton there were not one uniforms, there were two uniforms, and the younger boys wore the so-called jackets, the striped trousers, the little jacket like that, and the Eton collar and so forth. And I'd always thought it was a bad idea to have a uniform which, as it were, distinguished the little boys as such. There are many reasons for this, and I'm sure you can think of one or two for yourselves. But for me, the essence of it was that, you know, a school was a great community, and to have, as it were, divided into by visually into two halves by the stupid second uniform, which I didn't think looked. I was never a great one for jackets, as it was called. More to the point, I said it was for the younger boys. It wasn't for the younger boys, it was done on height. And therefore there were one or two boys, older boys, who hadn't got to the necessary height, who were forced to still go around in jackets when their contemporaries were all dressed in the lovely tailcoat. And so I got up and I said, put forward the proposal that jackets should be abolished. And that we should all, that every, all boys should wear the tail coat. And to resolve the meeting, not having, you know, this was passed with acclamation, I'm glad to say. And so from that moment onwards, jackets disappeared. And then when I used to see these tiny, tiny children with their tiny, tiny tail coats, I'm afraid they looked very, very sweet indeed. That was for me a great pleasure.